Dear ladies and gentlemen, when I arrived about a week ago in Uganda, I was really excited to have the chance to actually spend a week with so many fellow practitioners to learn more about climate change adaptation, a thing which all of us know a lot about, but with still so much to learn. So today, after the field trips, after about 20 sessions with interesting panel discussions, after a lot of chat during the coffee breaks or around the campfire, I'm sure all of us will have some valuable insights to take home with them. Let me highlight some issues which I have found interesting and which came up a couple of times during the conference. One issue was raised in almost every session was the issue of trust and mutual respect. This applies when we engage with the communities, and one example was also building trust in government agencies, for example, meteorological services. When they communicate with simplified numbers or scientific numbers and the farmers just do what they think is indicated and then the weather just decides to be a little bit different than expected, and then the trust in the med service is lost, and it takes a lot of time of workshops, participative scenario planning, and working on joint definitions, joint understanding to actually rebuild the trust. Another issue which I would like to highlight is that the need to get CBA and EBA to scale. It's just not enough to have a really fantastic demonstration site. We just have to get out of the niche of this lovely community, but we have to go mainstream. This will need new partnerships and also more efforts in the design of our interventions, that they are actually more independent of a specific project to push them, but they should convince the people to take them up by themselves, by their design, by their effectiveness. I would like to thank the organizers that they have put the role of ecosystems for adaptation at the center of the conference. You might know that the International Climate Initiative, IIED, from the German Ministry for the Environment, is actually putting a lot of funding into EBA. It's the most important funding priority from our adaptation funding window, because we think it's worth investing in EBA. We think it works, at least that's what a growing body of evidence is indicating. We also think it's worth
should talk about the potential trade-offs. For example,
if we manage a certain ecosystem to improve adaptive capacities for the ecosystem services, they might not be available to produce cash crops, which might actually provide income to meet important consumption and investment needs. However, communities cannot do this alone. They need enabling framework conditions, they need know-how, technical support, and they need access to climate finance. And what do we need? We need more evidence on the effectiveness of EVA, in which context does which measure work, how can we integrate closer with more technical approaches. And we need to make a strong economic case, for example through cost-benefit analysis or other economic tools. Last but not least, we have to strengthen our monitoring and evaluation to actually analyze the impact we are having in a more systematic manner. So let me close with some of the lessons learned or what we should do more when we leave this, this conference. First, I think we should follow the principle of fund globally, act locally. The international community has committed to mobilize $100 billion a year for climate change in developing countries. While this will probably not be enough to meet all adaptation needs, it is actually quite a big sum, and this might also lead to a preference for rather big adaptation programs. So we need to ensure that such programs with rather high volume actually put the communities, don't forget the communities. So for example, that you build it into your funding structure to have NGOs playing a big role in having small grant facilities or having innovative finance mechanism which put the communities at the center of climate finance. Second, the big funding volume might also help to solve the issue of scaling up, because with bigger programs, this enables us to also go to scale. From a donor's perspective, we also have to deal with a challenge regarding community-based adaptation. Since most CBA interventions are defined together with the community in the beginning of the project, the precise description of the activities might not be available when your organizations are actually applying for funding. For us donors, it might be or often is difficult to actually approve a project without knowing exactly what you will do with the money. So, on the one hand, the donors need to learn to be a bit more open to the uncertainty as part of CBA. But scientifically sound evidence about the effectiveness and efficiency, as well as good monitoring systems, might help us, on the other hand, to still have a strong case why we should invest in CBA. Third, what is clear is that all these challenges cannot be solved by one organization on its own, but we have to increase our cooperation, our coordination, and our exchange. So, next to forums such as this conference, there are many other possibilities to do that. One example would be the Friends of Ecosystem-Based Adaptation, FIBA, formal network, but also communities of practice on a global or regional scale. UNFCCC official channels also provide the possibility to improve coordination and exchange. So, on behalf of the German Ministry for the Environment, I thank everybody involved in this conference for all your inputs. A special thanks also to the organizers for our perfect logistics and the thematic guidance, and the Ugandan government for being such welcoming host. So I hope to see you all again at CBA 12. Thank you.